Hey, God bless you. This is Dr. John Radke from the Buffalo Valley Counseling Center and from the Grace Recovery Church Ministry. We're so glad that you tuned in today to our station, and today is May the 30th. Can you believe that? May the 30th, and 2016, and we are going to share a message from God's Word today. For you folks that are in recovery and you people who are members of our ministry, members of our church, we're so glad that you tuned in. Hey, the Grace Recovery Church is a ministry of Buffalo Valley Counseling Center, and we started this ministry to help Christians, particularly people who are struggling with codependency and with other types of addictions, such as drug addiction, alcoholism, overeating, compulsive addictions of any kind, pornography, sexual addiction, all of these things we can help you with, and we have materials that we can send you to help you with a daily 12-step program. We believe in the Christian 12 steps of recovery. We do not practice the 12 steps of recovery of AA or NA or the secular crowd. We believe that those are unbiblical, and we have taken the 12 steps of recovery from its original intention, and we have made them the way they're supposed to be from a Christian context. If you would like more information on this, we do have a book right here. I have one right here in my hand. It's called the Grace Recovery 12-Step Workbook. And this book is designed to help you in recovery so that you can use this as a daily program every day, along with a Bible. We recommend that you get a recovery Bible. There, actually, you can get them out there and use that along with this book. And in this book, we have the 12 steps of recovery. We have how to work the 12 steps. And we also have a bunch of information. We also have readings from the scripture that are in alphabetical order, it's a concordance, and it has all kinds of words in it that pertain to recovery counseling. And so we think this is a valuable resource. If you'd like a copy, you can write to us and we'll send you one of these. The cost is $6. We'll mail you one, as many copies as you want. Each copy is $6. And you can either mail us a check, you can pay us by a money order, or you could go on our site called GoFundMe.com and put my name in, Dr. John Radke, and then you can go in and pay by credit card. We also offer a ministry through Buffalo Valley Counseling and Grace Recovery Church for counseling online. So if you are a Christian and you need counseling and need help with any issue, whether it's depression or anxiety or abuse, you can contact us. And we can set up a counseling session in your own home, wherever you are in the United States. We can counsel you. All you have to do is have Skype or FaceTime in your computer, and we can then give you a counseling session right in the comfort of your own home. And you can pay for that ahead of time, and then we can give you counseling. So that's another ministry we offer through Buffalo Valley Counseling and Grace Recovery Church. So if you'd like one of these books, write to us. Our mailing address, and I'll put it above my head, is 8 Lar Circle, New Columbia, Pennsylvania, 17856. Our telephone number is 570-568-8500. So if you call us, you write to us, contact us, even on Facebook, which we have. We have a Facebook page. We have a Twitter page. We are on Google+. We also have two websites that you can find on the Internet. And so you can find out all the information you want to know about us and what we believe, our doctrinal stand, etc. And you can look that up on the Internet. So if you'd like one of these, write to us. We'll send it to you. Okay? All right. Well, today we're going to get right into the Word of God. And we're going to study on a really, really neat subject. I'm excited about this subject. So let's pray and ask God to bless us as we look into His Word. Our sermons at Grace Recovery Church are for people in recovery. These are unique sermons that are for people who are battling with addiction, and we want to kind of emphasize the Word of God and help you guys grow as you're doing your 12-step recovery work. And today our sermon is on empathy deficit disorder. That's right, EDD is called. Empathy deficit disorder is the title of my sermon. And before we look into God's Word, though, let's pray and ask God to bless us. Father God, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be on the airways today, and we pray that you would bless this message and bless me as I preach this message so that I might be able to share my thoughts from my heart that the Holy Spirit gave me so that I could help the folks that are listening today that are battling with recovery. And we pray that this message would go forth and help many people, and other folks would hear it, and they would link it up on their internet, and they would share it with their friends and neighbors who are battling with recovery so that they might get help as well. We thank you so much for this time that we can share the Word of God, and we pray that you would just bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you. We're so glad that you tuned into our station. Hey, if you have your Bibles, turn to Mark chapter 1, and we're going to look at two verses. Actually, I'm going to read verse 40 and verse 41. I'm going to read 40 because 40 gives us the context of our key verse, but our key verse today is verse 41. But let me get my Bible out. I'm going to be reading from the Recovery Bible right here, and let's just read that together. I'll put it on the screen so that you can follow along with us. And this is about the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it says in the Recovery Bible, the heading is, Jesus heals a man with leprosy. So starting at verse number 41, here's what it says. It says, a man with leprosy came and knelt in front of Jesus. And begging to be healed, he said, if you are willing, you can heal me and make me clean, he said. So this is the leper speaking to Jesus. And the Bible says in verse 41, here's our key verse, it says, moved with compassion, Jesus reached out and touched him. And he says, I am willing, Jesus said, be healed. And instantly the leprosy disappeared and the man was healed. So that is verse we read verse 40, 41, and of course verse 42. So we see here a simple passage, but here's what we want to focus on today. The reason why 41 is our key verse is, as recovering Christians, we want to focus in today on this word, the word compassion. The word compassion. Jesus was moved with compassion. Now, you know, we know a lot about God theologically, don't we? Now, some of you might have, you've studied a little bit of theology, and you know what the Bible says about God. But we know that God, first of all, is love, don't we? We know that the Bible says God loves us. And, of course, John 3:16 is a verse that teaches us about God's love. It says, for God so loved the world. We also know that God is holy. God says in the Word of God, be holy as I am holy. We also know that he's omniscient. The word omniscient means that he's all-knowing. He's also omnipresent. That means that the Bible says that God is everywhere. There isn't a place where he is not. He is omnipresent, means he's with you, he's with me, he's in throughout the entire world. There, he is omnipresent. We also know the Bible teaches that he's righteous. And, of course, going along with his holiness, he's righteous. That means that he does the right thing. He corrects wrongs. and he's always concerned about doing the right thing, that which is right, that which is pure, that which is holy. But did you ever realize that the Bible teaches, and here in our text today, we want to focus on this word, that Jesus, that God, is compassionate. He is compassionate. You know, Jesus was God. Of course, he was the second person in the Trinity, wasn't he? God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And Jesus was God in the flesh, and in his earthly ministry, he displayed compassion more than any man in history, even to the point of his death on the cross. The reason why Jesus died on the cross and went there in obedience to his Heavenly Father was not just because he wanted to be dutiful and obey his Father, but the reason Jesus went to the cross was because of his compassion. Even when Jesus was on the cross, he turned to one of the thieves and he said, this day you will be with me in paradise. He had compassion on one of the thieves that put his faith and believed in Jesus Christ. So we want to focus in on the word compassion today. And remember, the title of our sermon is Empathy Deficit Disorder. Now, I'm going to explain that in a minute, where I got that from. But let's take a look at the word compassion, first of all. You know, in the Greek New Testament, the word compassion sounds a little bit different. Let me give you the Greek word. It's called splashnitsuma. Splashnitsuma sounds like a water park. Splash, but that's splashnitsuma. Actually, the word splash in the Greek language is the word for our internal organs. Our basically our intestinal area. Or we call it our bowels. And splashnitsuma means to be moved with one's internal parts or their bowels. To be moved with compassion, to yearn with compassion. That's what splashnitsuma means. Okay? Now, we understand the word from Greek, but let's look at what the problem is. We're going to look at this sermon, the problem. Now, Douglas Baylor, who is a psychologist, not necessarily a Christian psychologist, I was reading an article that he had posted online, and he had conducted a study in the United States primarily, and he found that many people in our society are suffering from something he calls empathy deficit disorder. There you have it. Now, some of you are familiar with ADD, that's attention deficit disorder, and then there's ADHD, that's attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, but he's talking about EDD, and EDD is empathy deficit disorder. Now, what is empathy? Well, let me explain it to you. LeBert defines EDD as a person's inability to step outside themselves and tune in to what other people are experiencing, especially when it comes to identifying other people's feelings. People with EDD, he said, have difficulty understanding the thinking and the beliefs of people who are different than themselves. EDD is a source of personal conflict in communication, and it breaks down intimate relationships. And it says of adversarial attitudes, including hatred towards groups of people who differ in their beliefs, traditions, and values or ways of life from the other individual or from the person. LeBert goes on and says, now, he's not a Christian. I want to point that out. He is not a Christian man, but he believes, as he did his study, that the world is at a dangerous tipping point. He said EDD is at epidemic proportions and is making the world a very unsafe and dangerous place to live. What he's saying is, LeBert is basically saying, is that because people have no empathy for others, they don't care. And so what if you have a flat tire in the middle of the highway? You ever see somebody do that? Someone has a flat tire, and people will just go by them. They won't stop to help because they're paranoid or afraid, or they're too busy, they're too in a rush. So there's a lot of times when tragedies will happen in our society, and the most of people, maybe if we took 10 people, maybe one or two people out of those 10 would actually stop and help. The other 8 or 9 would just, they'll just go right by the tragedy. They don't want to get involved. And we have in our world, he's saying, a lack of empathy or compassion toward other people. So compassion and empathy are very similar, aren't they? Compassion is when you see the needs of other people and you're moved and you want to do something about it. That's what Jesus was like. He was like that. He was a compassionate. God is compassionate toward us. And we need to understand that not only God is holy, God is loving, but he's compassionate. And thank God, praise the Lord, that he is compassionate. But let me go on. Let me give you an illustration. LeBert also, in his articles, gave an example of what he meant by EDD. He says, take a man who told me that his wife always complain that he didn't spend enough time with their children, and that he had most of, that she had most of the burden despite having a career of her own. Well, he said, yeah, I see her point, the man said, in a neutral voice. But I need time for my sports activities, he said, on the weekends, and I'm not going to give that up. And then he said, then he went on, he says, and at night I'm tired, and when I come home, I just want to sit down and veg out. And as we talked further, LeBaire said, the psychologist, he says, it became really clear to me that this man simply didn't experience what his wife's world was like for her on the inside. His own reality, he said, specifically his own needs, were his only reality. End of quote. So LeBaire did this study. He finds that we are suffering in the United States primarily of EDD. Now, is he right? Well, as I'm looking at society every day, and if you're looking at society every day, I would say he's onto something. We have a deficit disorder in the area of people's compassion and people's empathy toward others. And you know what's really serious, what's really scary, is that this is creeping into the local church. It's creeping into Christian churches where Christians should really care and be empathetic and compassionate. But many times they say, well, I don't want to get involved. I'm just too busy. Now, when you look at this lack of compassion, this lack of empathy, some people would call this narcissistic behavior. Narcissism is when someone is just focused on self, me, myself, and I. But others might just call this pure selfishness. But when we study the Bible, what we find is this problem goes all the way back to the book of Genesis when Adam and Eve fell in the Garden of Eden. When they fell into sin, God pronounced a curse upon man because of their disobedience to him. And from that very moment, man had a fallen nature. He had an old sin nature. And his sin nature was then passed on to his children and his children's children all the way to you and I. So when we're born in this world, the Bible says that we are born with a sin nature. Now, that sin nature, that old sin nature, will not go away until the rapture, until Jesus Christ comes back, takes us home to be with him in glory. We will always have that old sin nature, because the old sin nature is actually intertwined in our flesh, our body, our human body. It's part of that. And so we have this old sin nature. Now, what is the old sin nature like? Well, it's selfish, it's lazy, it's self-centered. And so when we allow our flesh, our old sin nature, to control us, we then can lack compassion, we can lack empathy toward other people, because we're focused in on ourselves, we're centered in on ourselves, and that's what the old sin nature does. So the Bible says, Paul wrote extensively about this in his epistles, he said, put off the old man and put on the new man. He's saying, get rid, he said, subdue, starve the old sin nature, don't let it dominate you. And he says, and let the new nature in Christ flourish and grow. He said, feed the Spirit of God, the spiritual things. Be filled with the Spirit, he said. Be filled with the Spirit, and then you'll manifest the things that we should. And some of those fruits of the Spirit are compassion and empathy. And you see, so when we allow the old sin nature to dominate us and to control us, we will lack empathy. We will lack compassion toward other people. Now, let's be really honest, and I'm talking to you people who are addicts, okay? You people are in recovery. When you are in your addiction, let's be honest, we are all, as human beings, self-centered because we have an old nature. But when you're an addict, you are selfish to the 10th power. Let's just put it that way. To the 10th power. That's all you think about is yourself. You think about getting your next fix. You think about using drugs. You think about stealing money. You still think about lying and how you're going to manipulate somebody to get this so you can get your fix. the addiction is completely, totally dominated by the old sin nature. And so you are completely selfish, self-centered, almost narcissistic. And this is why addiction is such a distortion from what God wants us to experience as Christians and as human beings. God doesn't want us to be self-centered, focused on self, me, myself, and I. What can I get out of this? That's the way our world is. The Bible says when you become a Christian, that needs to change. God wants us to be other-centered. God wants us to think about what we do and how we do it and what we say and how it will affect other people, not just about ourselves. So we need to have compassion. We need to have empathy. But we're suffering from empathy deficit disorder. That's what the Bible's saying. Now, you know, as I was looking at the 12 steps, and I'm going to share the two of the steps that pertain to this whole issue. Is step number 8, let me read it to you. Step number 8 in the Christian 12 steps says this: I will make a list of all persons I have harmed and ask for their forgiveness. So as a Christian, when we are in Christian recovery, we need to sit down and say, okay, now when I was active in my addiction, how many people did I hurt? People that I disenfranchised, people that I stole from, that I lied to, that I manipulated. There's a lot. But God wants us to go through that list and write it down, each one very painfully, write them down and say, you know what? I need to make a list, first of all, of everyone that I hurt in my addiction. But then we go to step number 9, and here's what it says. I will make direct amends with those people on my list that I have hurt, or with those who have hurt me. So sometimes there are even people in our addiction that have hurt us as we've been using in our addiction, and we're active in our addiction. There were people that not only did we hurt, but they hurt us. So it says that I'm going to make amends with not only people that I've hurt, but also with people that have hurt me. And I'm going to practice biblical forgiveness, except when to do so could injure or hurt the other person. So the ninth step says we need to make amends. Now, I go back to Zacchaeus in the Bible. Remember Zacchaeus, the tax collector? And he was a thief, and he was a liar and a cheat. He worked for the Roman government. He ran around collecting taxes from all the people where he lived. And he always collected more than he needed, way more than he needed. And so he basically, he scammed these people. He would literally take money from them that was it would go directly to his pocket, and then he would pay the Roman government the taxes because he was a tax collector. And the people hated Zacchaeus. They hated him because they knew he was crooked. And he was almost like a mafia leader. Well, after, when Jesus came to his town, Zacchaeus met Jesus. He came up to him, and he was just a short little man. He's up in a tree. Jesus says, Zacchaeus, come down from the tree. I want to come to your house. I want to talk to you today. And Zacchaeus, he said, wow, he wants to talk to me? I'm a tax collector, and nobody likes me. Everyone hates me. And he knew him by name. And Jesus went to his home, and he spoke to Zacchaeus about the Lord and about salvation, about giving his life to God. And that day, a tremendous transformation took place in Zacchaeus' life. Man, he was born again. He was saved. He was converted. His life changed. He invited Jesus Christ as the Messiah because he was Jewish. See, he did not believe in the Messiah, but he put his faith in Jesus as the Messiah, the one who was going to come in the name of the Lord, and he trusted Jesus Christ, and Zacchaeus was wonderfully saved. And you know what the first thing he did, the very first thing that Zacchaeus did, he says, you know what, Jesus, I stole money and I hurt and embezzled a lot of people in my lifetime. And you know what I'm going to do? Because I'm a born-again Christian, because I'm saved now, and you put joy and love and peace in my heart, I want to make that right. I want to make amends. So Zacchaeus went to every single house. Can you imagine? He went to every single house, knocked on the door, and said, they went, oh no, it's Zacchaeus. He's here for some more money. He says, no, I want to give you the money back that I stole from you. And they probably sat there with their mouths open going like, what? Are you kidding me? And he handed them bags of money and said, here's money that I stole from you, dishonest. I took it in taxes. I usurped more money than I needed, and I feel bad. And maybe even Zacchaeus that day said, hey, I put my trust in Messiah. I believe in Jesus. He's the one to come. And he witnessed to him. Now, that's what step eight and nine is all about. See, when you are a recovering Christian, we believe in Christian recovery that you are to do that instantly. You don't wait for months and months and months and months and say, oh, well, I didn't get to step number eight and step number nine. That's way down the list. Actually, step number eight and nine should happen right after three. Right after you made a decision to turn your life and your will over to the care of Christ. And if you became a born-again Christian and saved, the next thing you want to do is make right what you've done wrong. Now, it also says be careful, because some people you should not approach. There are some situations you can't go back and change, because if you do, it could not only harm you, it could do great harm to you, it could also do great harm to someone else. Let's say, for instance, you had an affair. Let's say you had an affair with some person's wife, and you write a letter to her and say, hey, I'm really sorry, I became a Christian now, I want to make amends, but you send it in the mail, and the woman you had the affair with, her husband opens the letter and said, what's this all about? And he doesn't know anything about it. And, of course, you could end up causing problems in their marriage. So that's what we're saying in step number nine. Be careful when you make amends that you do it biblically. And let's go on and define that. Now, how is that done? How do you make amends? How do you have compassion? How do you have empathy toward others? And you should. And how do you go and make amends? Well, let me share with you very specifically how you do that. God gives us a formula in Matthew chapter 15 and verses 15 to 18. And I'll put it on the overhead so you can follow along. Here's what it says. It says, if your brother or sister sins against you, humbly go to them and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. Verse 17, it says, if they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. We just got done talking about Zacchaeus. He was a tax collector. People hated him. People shunned him. And that's what Jesus is saying here. He's saying, listen, if they won't listen to you, treat them like a publican, a pagan, an unbeliever, or a tax collector. And then in verse 18 he says, truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. So there you have it. Jesus said, here's how you make amends. You go to this person one-on-one, privately, confidentially, and try to talk to them and share with them. Now, sometimes you can't do that. Sometimes you can't go to that person in person. Sometimes you have to write them a letter. Sometimes you need to make a telephone call. Sometimes you could send a telegram. I wouldn't advise sending a text message. I think that's too impersonal. But you certainly want to be careful that you don't put something in writing either, because it could be made public and it could be used against you and the other person. So you want to be careful. Be smart. Have good wisdom here, and go to that person one-on-one, talk to them and say, look, I just became a Christian. I got my life straightened out with the Lord, and I want to make things right with you. And so that's what you need to do. And Jesus says do that. Now, maybe you need to take somebody with you for backup, so that there can be clarity in case something gets out of control. Maybe the person gets angry at you, don't understand why you're coming or what's your purpose. You want to have somebody there. I also like this passage because it gives the church authority to discipline people who are members of their church. You know, many churches don't do this today. There are Christians in the churches that are living in sin today, in good, godly, Bible Christian churches that are living in sin, and the leadership, the pastor and the elders, the deacons, they do nothing about it. They just turn their eyes the other way, turn their head the other way. They don't look at it, pretend like it's not there. The Bible says that we need to go to those people in love, but we need to discipline. We need to tell them, listen, what's going on in your life? Why are you doing this? You cannot be doing this. And we need to win them back, to reconcile. The purpose of going is to make amends, to reconcile. It's not to judge, okay? So Jesus tells us to do a person-to-person intervention. In counseling, we call this kind of thing an intervention. However, sometimes it's not the best way to handle a conflict. A personal handwritten letter sometimes will do, not a text message. Now, notice Jesus also says the offended is to go to the offender to initiate the process of reconciliation. So the offended person is to go to the offender. Isn't that just the opposite the way the world thinks? What usually happens is that we focus on the hurt in our life and we want to seek revenge rather than forgiveness. And the last thing we want to do is to look at it from the other person's point of view. And that's what compassion is, and that's what empathy is. See, when we have compassion and we have empathy, we're able to look at this situation from the other person's point of view. And we go there to resolve the problem. Now, many of us, I believe today, many of us have lost the ability to feel compassion and empathy toward others, especially if we're recovering from addiction. You know, when you're in addiction and you're in active addiction and then you get into a recovery program, one of the things that we need to work on is compassion and empathy, because what happens to us when we're in addiction, we lose the ability to feel our feelings toward other people and for ourselves. We become callous. We become kind of bland, kind of neutral. We have no feelings. And sometimes we even need to go back to counseling, to a Christian counselor like myself, to work on this issue so we can work on our ability to feel feelings that we should feel. But we need to have compassion toward other people. And we lose that ability in addiction. It just kind of becomes stunted in its development or neutralized. And we need to regain that ability to feel. Okay? Now, if Jesus is our higher power in recovery, and he is, and if he's our role model as a Christian in recovery, then we need to be like him, don't we? And Jesus was compassionate and empathetic toward others. So if we're going to be like Jesus Christ, we need to be empathetic. We need to be compassionate. And I'm going to give you three examples of illustrations in the Bible where Jesus was compassionate. And I want us to learn from Jesus. We want to see what he did, and then by taking his example, we can learn from it, and we can start to be convicted and be driven and motivated to work on this area in our own life. Okay? Well, the first one I want to look at is, number one, Jesus had compassion for the physical infirmities of others. First of all, Jesus had compassion for the physical infirmities, of others. You remember in Matthew chapter 20, there were two blind men that were sitting on the road of Jericho. And as Jesus passed by, they spoke to the Lord Jesus Christ. And let's pick it up at verse 29. It says, as Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jericho, a large crowd followed him. And two blind men were sitting by the roadside, and when they heard that Jesus was going by, they shouted, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And the crowd rebuked them and told them to be quiet. But they shouted all the louder. They said, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. Jesus stopped and called them. What do you want to do with me? And what do you want me to do for you? He said. The Lord, they said, they answered, we want our sight. And in verse 34 of Matthew 20, it says, Jesus, here's our word again in the Greek. Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes, and immediately they received their sight and followed him. So Jesus saw a physical need. These men were blind. Two men were blind. He didn't just heal one blind man. He healed two blind men simultaneously. There is absolutely no question that was a miracle of God. And all the people that stood around were amazed and glorified God because of it. And that is why Jesus performed miracles, by the way, in the New Testament. He performed them so that God would receive glory for that miracle. How about this one? Remember in Matthew chapter 14, just before Jesus was feeding the 5,000 people that were following him, and he sat them down and fed them the little barley loaves and the fishes, and he prayed over them, and they were multiplied. Remember all that? Well, in John 14 and verse 14, here's what it says. When he went ashore, he saw the large crowd. And here's what it says again. Here's our word. And felt compassion for them and healed their sick. So before he fed them, before he fed the 5,000, the Bible says, as he was coming to the shore, he saw this huge group of people that were following him. Why were they following him? Because they believed he was the Messiah. They believed that they could receive healing. Stories were traveling rapidly through the land that there was a miracle worker. And you can imagine, people came with their beds and their crutches, and people that had leprosy and they were blind. And the Bible says that Jesus healed many of them. Do you know the Bible never records any of that? And someday when we get to heaven, we're going to meet some of those people that Jesus healed and say, oh yeah, I had leprosy and I was blind and I was lame and I was crippled from birth, and Jesus touched me and healed me. Can you imagine? Won't that be neat to be in heaven to meet some of those people? So in Matthew 14, verse 14, there's our word again. It says he had compassion. Then we also see that this happened again just before he fed the 4,000 in Matthew chapter 15, and verse 32, here's what it says. And Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I feel compassion for the people. There's that word again. Because they have remained with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat, and I do not want them to send them away hungry, for they might faint on the way. So Jesus again saying in Matthew 15, verse 32, I have compassion on these people because they're starving. So Jesus had compassion for physical infirmities and physical needs. The last illustration I want to show you having to do with compassion and physical needs is found in James chapter 2. Jesus wants us to have compassion, and he taught his disciples the same thing. And James, the brother of Jesus, writes in chapter 2, verses 15 and 17. Listen what he says. If a brother or sister is without clothing and is in need of daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm and be filled, and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? Even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead, being by itself. Great, great scripture. So James is saying, as a Christian, we need to be compassionate. We need to help people in their physical needs. Not only do they need the gospel, they need the good news of Jesus Christ, but they also need physical things, water, food, clothing. This is what missionaries do when they go. And missionaries not only give them the good news of Jesus Christ, but they also give them food. They give them medicine. They give them clothing. Sometimes they just don't have any water. The living conditions are unbelievable. We'll be reading about that a little bit later in my sermon. So, in the first area, I want to show you as an example. Jesus was compassionate toward people and their physical needs and physical infirmities. You and I need to be concerned about that as well. We need to be concerned about people's physical needs and physical infirmities. I believe that is what God wants us to do. Secondly, a second example I want to show you is that people, Jesus was compassionate with people struggling with sin and with Satan. In Luke chapter 7, verse 44 and 48, we have this. It says, "Then Jesus turned toward the woman and said to Simon, 'Do you see this woman? I came into your house, and you did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time she entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been given little loves little.' Then Jesus said to her, 'Your sins are forgiven.'" Remember this woman in Luke chapter 7? She comes in, Jesus is sitting with his disciples, and she breaks a bottle of perfume, pours it on Jesus' feet, and washes his hair, or washes his feet with her hair, and anoints his feet, and cries and weeps in mercy. And Jesus was so taken back by this. He was blessed. He was blessed by this woman, and he forgave her her sins. And Jesus was saying, this woman is struggling. This woman has struggled in her life with sin and with Satan. And he saw her need, and the Bible says here that Jesus had compassion on her, and he forgave her of her sins. You know, when we see people that are striving and struggling in addiction, struggling with sin, we need to have compassion on them. Especially if we've been there and we're in recovery, we should have compassion on our fellow brothers and sisters to see that they're struggling too, just like we were struggling. So often Christians and churches judge people who are addicts. They don't open their doors to addicts. They close their doors. They're afraid of them. And they shouldn't be. They should be compassionate. They should be empathetic. And they should open up their hearts and their ministry so they can help people. Also, we find this reference in Luke chapter 15, verse 20. Jesus was compassionate for sinners returning home. It says, "So he got up and he came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him." There's our word again. "And he ran and embraced him and kissed him." Where is that from? Remember, that's the story of the prodigal son. And the whole story about the prodigal son is about God and about us wandering off and going astray and being rebellious. And then we came to a place where we came to repentance and realized we were sinful, realized we were wrong. And the prodigal son came home, and when the father saw him, he ran down the lane and embraced him and hugged him. And the Bible says he showed compassion. He had compassion. There's our word again. So, we also find out, we see here, that God wants us to have compassion for sinners. In James chapter 5, verse 20, here's what it says. "Let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins." So, Jesus was compassionate with Christians, or people who were struggling with sin and wanted forgiveness and repentance, and we needed to have compassion and empathy to them too. Number three, another third example is Jesus showed compassion toward large masses of people. In Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 and 36, here's what it says. "Jesus was going through all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. And seeing the people, he felt," and here's a word, "compassion for them, because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd." So here we find in the Word of God, Jesus sees great crowds of people, and he has compassion on them. We have huge crowds of people in our world today that are starving, that need the gospel of Jesus Christ. We need to be missions-minded Christians. I am so thankful that I attend and go to a church, Christian Missionary Alliance Church, and right in their very statement of who they are, it says Christian Missionary Alliance. They are missionaries. They believe very strongly in missions. They support missions. They have missionaries all over the world, not only in the United States, but throughout the world, and they're reaching people with Christ. I'm so thankful that I'm in a church that's missions-minded. And if you're in a church that is not missions-minded, then they are really not the way that Jesus is. Jesus was compassionate. Jesus reached out to the masses and the people that are hurting all over the world. We need to stop being focused on ourselves. We need to be concerned about other people around us. Now, how do you feel about masses of people with no hope and without God in the world? How do you really feel about that? Philippians 4, verse 5 tells us, it says, "Let your gentle spirit be known to all men." Now, I want to read you an illustration that I found. This is the predicament in the country of India right now, and I want to ask you a question after I'm done with this illustration. Do you know in the country of India, the children in India are decimated? Many of the street children have run away from their homes and have done so because they were beaten or sexually abused. Tragically, their homelessness can lead to further abuse through explorative child labor and prostitution in India. Not only does abuse rob away children their material security, but it also leaves them emotionally scarred for the rest of their life. Many of the abused children in India encounter trauma. They are traumatized, and some refuse to even speak in some of the missions where they're found. They don't even speak for months because they're so traumatized. Many children often feel guilty and even blame themselves for the mistreatment. Most Indian street children work. In Jaipur, a common job is rag picking. Can you imagine? In which boys and girls as young as 6 years old sift through garbage in order to collect recyclable material. The children usually rise before dawn and carry their heavy load in a large bag over their shoulder. Rag pickers can be seen alongside pigs and dogs searching through trash, heaps on their hands and knees. Many babies are aborted in India, abandoned or deliberately aborted and neglected simply because they are female. Half of all the children in India are malnourished. But for the street children, the proportion is much higher. Street children live and work amidst the trash, animals, and open sewers. Not only are they exposed to susceptible to disease, they are also unlikely to be vaccinated or even receive any kind of medical treatment. Only 2 in 3 Indian children have been vaccinated in India. The HIV and AIDS rate among Indians and adults is 0.7%. And so has, it's not, it's at epidemic proportions in India. There's something like 5 million people, in other words, in India that are affected with AIDS. This is what it's like in India. Now, when I read that story, just that statistic alone, I'm going to ask you a question. How does that make you feel? You say, well, yeah, well, that's India. That's not the world I live in. I live in the United States. I live in Pennsylvania. That really doesn't affect me, but it should. When you read stories like that, when you see documentaries on TV about people who are starving in the world, people who are living in just unbelievable conditions, our heart should go out. Our heart should be filled with compassion and empathy. We should want to do everything we can to help these people because they need our help. If we don't help them, who will? Who will help these people? Now, so you see, in the three different examples we gave, Jesus was compassionate. He was compassionate and empathetic. Aren't you glad that Jesus was? Because Jesus was compassionate to us. Now, if you're here today and you're listening to this message and you're wondering maybe, well, is Jesus willing to help me? Is Jesus willing to have compassion on me? Do you doubt Jesus' ability to help you? Well, let me read this scripture for you. Mark chapter 9, verse 22 and 23, it says, "It has often thrown both him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, if you can, all things are possible to him who believes. And here was this is a scripture in Mark talking about a person who was demon possessed, and Jesus said, if you believe, it can be done. Do you doubt God? Do you doubt his willingness to help you? Let's go back to our key verse, our key reference, and we'll close with that. In Mark chapter 1, verse 41, it says, "Move with compassion." There's our word, compassion. Jesus stretched out his hand, and he touched him and said, "I am willing, be cleansed." Jesus cleansed this leprous man in Mark chapter 1 in our text. And he said, "Lord, if you're willing, he said, "Could you heal me?" And Jesus said, I'm willing. Listen, maybe you need Jesus in your life today. You're a recovering Christian, and you need compassion. You need empathy. I'm here to tell you that Jesus is compassionate. Jesus is empathetic. He wants to heal you. He wants to take away your addiction. You need to come to him and let him transform your life and to become your higher power. He can do that for you. But if you're also a recovering Christian, and you lack compassion, you lack empathy, I want to encourage you to work on that issue in your recovery. We need to care about others. We need to feel like Jesus feels. Are you willing to do that? Stop focusing on yourself and see the needs of other people. We are suffering from empathy deficit disorder in our society. And I pray that you, as a recovering Christian, will ask God to change you and transform you into someone that really cares about others around you, and that you'll make amends with those people who you've hurt and you have cheated and lied to and stole from, that you will go back and do a step 8 and do a step 9, and you will do it immediately because God wants you to have forgiveness, and God wants you to have empathy, and he wants you to have compassion. Well, I hope and pray that this message has helped you today. God bless you. We pray for you in your recovery. If you need any help, you can contact us. Again, our address is 8 Lahr Circle, New Columbia, Pennsylvania, 17856. You can write us or call us. Our number is area code 570-568-8500. This is Dr. John Radke from the Grace Recovery Church and the Buffalo Valley Counseling Center, and we hope and pray that you'll keep on keeping on in the Lord, that you'll keep working on your 12-step recovery. If you want any materials, contact us. If you want individual counseling, contact us. And we hope and pray that you'll listen to these videos and pass it along to your friends who really need help. But I pray that this Memorial Weekend, that God will bless you and he will give you an opportunity to show compassion and empathy to someone in your life this week. God bless you, and I pray that God will just help you in your life.